Yeah, so the question was, when you're calling a procedure on a list, like in particular, there's this procedure on the homework called interleave. And it's supposed to interleave two lists. You can read about it if you want. Why can't you just pass in, oh, sorry, no commas in scheme, two lists like that? Instead, all the examples have them quoted. And you can actually see in the syntax highlighting the reason. When you do not quote expression that is parentheses around some numbers, Scheme treats this as a call expression. It treats one as a procedure that it tries to call on the arguments 2, 3, 4. But since it's a number, you get an error. Okay, so the actual error we got is that there's no interleave. But if we try this on, for example, car of 1, 2, 3, 4, I'm going to get this error that says int is not callable because before it ever called car, it tried to figure out what this thing is, and it did it by trying to call one on 2, 3, and 4. So that's why that quote is there, is to make sure that when this gets evaluated, it doesn't try to call one as if it were a procedure. Instead, it just leaves it as a list. Excellent question. Excellent question. So, what's the difference between list something, something, something versus cons something, something? List can take as many arguments as you want, but they're all elements of the result. So here's an element, and here's another element, and here's another element. What you get is a list containing these three elements, or however many you type out. So, the example you've seen me probably type before is list 1, 2, 3, but you could have other things in here. Like if you put an empty list, you'd end up with a list of two elements, one and the empty list. Cons always only takes two arguments, and only the first one is an element. This is a shorter list. Cons is particular in that it needs the second argument to be a list. It can't be a number. And what you get when you evaluate your whole cons expression is a list that starts with this element and has all the elements of the shorter list. So you can cons one onto an empty list to get a list that has one and all the elements of this. Well, there aren't any elements in this, which is why there's nothing after the one. But if I cons to this onto a list containing 2, 3, and 4, then I would end up with that. If, by the way, I wrote down a list with two elements, one, and a list containing 2, 3, and 4, I get an extra set of parentheses. Okay, so the question was about lab 11, which is a new lab, by the way. This contents of this lab used to be part of the project, but we've now put them in the lab so that we can just let the project be more reasonable. But that means it's a very complicated lab because it covers a complicated topic, which is parsing. Okay, so I would say that these doc tests are a little bit hard to read. So I want to describe what we're trying to achieve, and then we'll talk about how the code works. What we're trying to achieve is to turn strings into some kind of expression that's easier to evaluate. So, like the strings might have, extra spaces in them, they might go in multiple lines, but at the end of the day, we want to figure out what procedure we're calling, and we want to know what we're calling it on. And this structure makes it easy to do that because you look at the first thing in the pair, oh, it's the plus procedure. You look at the rest of the pair, oh, those are all the arguments we're going to call it on. So the point of parsing in general, or reading as we call it here, is to take raw text and turn it into a tree structure or a linked list structure that describes what you're doing. And why did I say tree structure? Well, because there might be nesting in here, right? This could say 1 plus, you know, times 2, 3, 4, and then you end up getting some kind of hierarchical thing at the end. So how did I do on describing what we're trying to do here? We're trying to go from just like raw text into a data structure that's easy to pass into an interpreter and then figure out its value. All right, what's involved? Well, basically, this describes how a programming language works. Scheme is made up of parentheses and numbers and symbols. That's kind of all there is. And so we're going to take in a string that's got parentheses and numbers and symbols in it, and we're going to try to generate a structure that's easy to represent. How do we do it? Well, instead of actually working on a string, we're going to work on a buffer that lets you get one token at a time. Oh my gosh, I used so many technical words. So let me talk about what those are. A buffer is kind of like a list and kind of like a string. I think it's easiest to think about it as like a list of strings that are words. And what are those words? Well, since this is a programming language, not a regular language, the words are parentheses or plus or one or two. They're not always one character long, like 23 would be just one token. And if this instead said car, that would be just one token. So in this example, they happen to all be kind of one character long, but really they're like whole words. Parenthesis is its own thing, plus is its own thing, one is its own thing, two is its own thing, close parenthesis is its own thing. But true and nil are their own things too. So think of this as a list of words, where pop first gives you whatever is at the beginning and then deletes it. So if we said sir.pop first, we would then have gotten rid of this parenthesis and stored it in val. And then we have this special case which says, well, when you hit a parenthesis, what do? And the answer is every time you hit a parenthesis, you're going to create a pair. A pair is like a link. It's something that has a first element and a rest and lets you represent a whole sequence. And why do we want to represent a whole sequence? Well, that's kind of what we have here. Is in parentheses, we have a sequence of things. They are plus one and two. So here I would say time to make a, oh, sorry, I'm in the wrong place. We found a parenthesis. I have to make a pair of first thing after the parenthesis, followed by everything until the closing parenthesis. Scheme code, like all scheme lists are linked lists, and scheme code is just like a long list of things like plus and one and two. So for that reason, we're using linked lists to represent these. You might wonder, like, how come we couldn't have just made this plus one and two? Totally reasonable. But what we're going to do with it in the interpreter is we're going to break it up into the plus to figure out what we're calling and the 1, 2 to figure out what we're calling it on. And this is actually a very natural thing to do with a linked list, is to get the first thing and to get the rest and then do like different things with the first and the rest. So that's one of the reasons why linked lists are so prominent in Scheme, is that, you know, Scheme, to interpret Scheme, what you want to do is get the first thing, figure out what it is, and then apply it to the rest. Okay, so how are we going to handle cases like one? Well, it turns out that it's none of these. It's this like boring thing at the end. One, just return one. So a lot of these are kind of fairly straightforward. Nil, you don't want to return the string nil. You want to return the nil that came from the pair class. So I mean, that's like one detail. I think if you read the lab, you'd get that. But really all the action is here. So the next question was, why do you have to call read tail? And what is that? Well, just like a list has a first thing and the rest of the list, this pair that we're building involves reading the first thing. Why do we have to read the first thing? Well, sometimes it's plus. We could have just put in the plus, but sometimes it's not plus. Sometimes it's like some really complicated whatever. So we're calling scheme read recursively in order to handle the fact that this might be something simple or it might be something complicated. And we want just a function that is able to handle both the simple and the complicated case. What about read tail? Read tail's job is just to keep calling scheme read over and over again on everything until you hit a closing parenthesis. So it's going to call scheme read on this, it's going to call scheme read on this. It's then going to notice that there's nothing left and it'll be done. So why wouldn't you just call scheme read recursively on each element until you got to the closing parenthesis? That is exactly what you want to do. And that's what read tail does. So you could have put all that code in here, but instead it's just in its own function. So all read tail does is call scheme read on each element of source until you find the end of the list, the like corresponding parenthesis to the one that you started with. So val is some open parenthesis. This says keep going till you find the corresponding closing parenthesis, calling scheme read on each thing along the way. If you hit a closing parenthesis, you're done. Otherwise, call scheme read in order to get the next thing. This is definitely a non-trivial piece of code, but it's an important one because there are lots and lots of cases in which there's some like text-based description of something, a Wikipedia page, whatever. That's like in a programming language that's not the programming language you're using, and you have to read it in. And you know, a lot of programming these days, there's already someone who's written this code for you, so you just call it. But it is important that when you're inventing a new text representation for data, that you can write a reader that that handles it. And so this is basically, they all look like this. They all look like, you know, read the first thing, read the rest of the things, put them together into a linked list, and then you're done. So the question is, what's the difference between quote and quasi-quote in scheme? We'll do a little Python first. In Python, if you make a string and you say, I am 2 times 20 plus 1 years old, you just get a string containing all these characters. But if instead you say, I want an F string, then what it does is it looks for anything that's bracketed and it actually evaluates it. This is like quotation and this is like quasi-quotation. In scheme, you can quote, I am plus times 220 years old, you'll just get a big nested list. But if you want to evaluate part of it, you need to quasi-quote. Just quasi-quoting isn't enough. You have to let it know which parts you want to evaluate. That's what the unquote is for. If instead, this is just a quoted expression, then it interprets this comma as an unquote, but it doesn't actually do anything with it. So we're kind of back in the Python case where you put the unquote, but you just like, now you see the brackets right there. And here you're seeing the unquote, like right there, but it doesn't do any evaluation. Yeah, good question. So only in quasi quotation does this get evaluated. In quotation, this never got evaluated. Mm-hmm. It just got rewritten. Like if you write this is the same as writing that, and unquote two is the same as writing unquote two. So like the comma is just kind of a shorthand for writing unquote. But it's not getting evaluated. Quoting a number doesn't really do anything. Why? Because evaluating a number doesn't do anything.
Okay.
Quotation just stops you from evaluating the number two, but two just evaluates to itself anyway. So it doesn't matter whether you quote it or not, you get the same thing. So the question was, in Python, it's supposed to be the case that repr x and x dot repr do the same thing.
Yes.
But for a number, it's not true. Why? In Python, you're not allowed to invoke a method on a number literal. So if instead I had set this to y and written y repr, it would have worked. But I can't just like slot in the number three. Why is that? Long ago, when Python was being created, they decided this was bad because three dot looks like you're about to like write a floating point number. So they just outlawed it. Yeah, I think this has been a characteristic of Python since the early days, but I don't know exactly how far it dates back. But it is just like a weird thing where you can't like, you can't invoke any methods on like underscore or otherwise. There's nothing you can do to the number three because they wanted to reserve this idea of writing three dot for, you know, writing number.